Thank you, everyone. First of all, I want to say it's very nice to see everyone in real life here after a few years. And I want to give a big thank you to all of you, because 2020 showed us that without you, this is not possible. So a big round of applause for all of you for being here. OK, so yeah, my name is Marco. I'm from the Open Robotics team at Intrinsic. And I want to show you today a story of the robotics world. I wanted to tell this story because there's a lot of people that don't belong to the robotics world, so they're not aware of what's been happening there in that industry. And especially, I want to show how open source and free software was a big enabler, and I think is the main reason that we have been evolving so fast and got us to this point in the robotics world. So this is a small GIF. It's a big video on YouTube, but this is a small chunk of it, of contributions to the ROS core, a visualization of the contributions. And I want to stop here to give a bit of a reflection on open source. I think that humanity grows as we collaborate together. So if we think about anything that we have, we could have not done it without the help of others, right? From a t-shirt to like a pen or computers, like anything, right? And I think through time, we have found different ways of collaborating together, like enterprises, countries, like there's many forms of collaboration, right? But they still pose boundaries to this collaboration. Like if you have an enterprise, you have to collaborate within the enterprise. If you have a country, you're not allowed to collaborate, or it's very hard to collaborate with other countries. Many of these barriers. And I think FOSS is bringing another dimension to this. So when we bring FOSS to humanity, like we're able to break these barriers and boost collaboration farther from these boundaries. And this is a story of how that happened in the robotics world and how that helped really boost the development. So there's three main softwares that I want to talk about. So the biggest one is ROS, which is the main framework that we use in robotics. The second one is Gazebo, which is focused in simulation for robotics, because without simulation, robotics would not be possible. And the third one is OpenRMF, which is a multi-robot platform that we're starting to develop. And it's actually getting a big big traction. And it's very relevant here today, because Singapore is actually leading the adoption and the development of this software. All right, so a bit about ROS. So the problem with robotics back in the day was that in every single lab, so robotics had a story of where like it was mostly developed on robotics labs, institutes, research, and all that. And then suddenly, towards the last few years, it's been moving towards the industry, right? So there's more industry, there's a bit less research. So at the time, it was mostly research labs, and then there was a lot of reinventing the wheel. Like you come up, you have to build a robot, you have to start from the scratch, you have to build this component, even though if your specialty is just perception, so you have to build every single thing from scratch, right? And that would lead to a lot of teams just focusing on one part and then not even developing the rest. So there was very, very few research teams that would have like an entire robot function. They would say, no, but I have this perception part, then I write my paper and that's all. Right? But the robot is never working. So it was very, very hard to get like ready, like a full solution ready, right? So there was this I would say company, part research lab called Wiro Garage that was started in Silicon Valley. And they started this PR2 program with this robot, and then they created a software for it that it was called ROS. And then they sent it to a bunch of robotics lab around the world, and then they started spreading the software. It was open source, and then all these research labs started doing the the state-of-the-art research on this, and then this got published online, and then suddenly you could just use the software and then put it on your robot and it would just run. And then you could do your research on top of that, right? So this reinventing the wheel stopped, and then we could all share our best contributions and then just improve it on what is our best specialty, right? And then after Wheel Garage, the Open Source Robotics Foundation was created to protect the software, and then took over ROS, and now is still the owner of this of these projects. So what is ROS? So ROS gives four main areas. It provides four main features. The main one is the plumbing, which is the one that everyone thinks when they think about ROS. So basically, the plumbing is in robotics we use this concept of components that talk to each other. So basically, ROS will be just that framework. You could think about it like as a communication framework. So basically, it's that framework that connects your components to each other. They talk to each other, and it allows you to introspect what's going on, to debug, and all that. There's a bunch of tools that you can use. That includes the introspection tools that I mentioned, but also like visualization and many other tools that are built by the community. And then also you get like capabilities, like for example, you get the navigation framework. So you can just, you get a robot and then you put the navigation stack and then it's running. Like you can get a robot working in one afternoon. Like there's nothing else you need to do. Just install Nav2 and get a Navgraph and it's running. So that is very nice. And there's a whole ecosystem of the community where you can just go to Discord, you can go to this community events, and everyone's there talking the same language, ready to help and ready to collaborate. So it's been more than 10 years of ROS, and this is the initial ROS that was created back at Wheel Garage, and all the distributions that we've been having. But because of the change that I mentioned, switching to industry, ROS has become a bit more, like the requirements have become a bit more different, and there's more need for the product to be ready to market, security, and all these things. So ROS was rewritten at some point, and now it's ROS 2. So these are the current releases. There's a rolling release that is the main one that we use for updating the packages all the time, and then we just freeze it and make the release out of that. So the next one will be coming in next May, which is not there, is Iron Irvine. There's many robots running ROS in like autonomous cars, NASA robots. There's a picture of the defunct Baxter. But if you go to robots.ros.org, you will see an incredible amount of robots that run ROS. Startups, there's many startups running ROS. A lot of them, there's so many that we don't even know because we ROS is MIT licensed, so some of the startups won't even say it. But these are some of them with some data of how they got acquired, how much money they managed to raise and all that. If you go to this, there's also this link that tries to keep track of the robotics companies, the companies that are using ROS. So how do we manage this? Like it's incredible, it's an incredible amount of people working together and incredible, it's a distributed way. So there's many different parts that work. So in robotics, people usually, the problem is so big that people usually specialize on something. So you might be the guy on perception, you might be the guy on navigation, you might be the guy on control, right? So what we do is we have this place called Discourse, where we all, it's basically a forum, we just post things there, and it's the main way of communicating stuff. And then there's working groups. So usually when you wanna create a working group, you post it on Discourse, you say, hey, I wanna be working on this, and then you just start working on that that thing. And you start making a meeting, and then people start joining, and then you start doing your your stuff for ROS, you create your repos, and then share community. And then there's a bit more structured part on top of that, which is called the technical steering committee, which is there's certain requirements that you need to meet, but once you meet them, you can join. And these are the current companies that are part of the steering committee. And they basically get together and decide what is going to be the next things to do for each working group. What is the main important things that ROS needs to move forward? There's a ROS2 logo at the bottom. That means there's three slots in the tier steering committee for community members. So there's three community members that are elected, and they're also part of this steering committee. All right, so gazebo. I want to talk about the simulation a little bit. I'm not going to stop too much, but basically gazebo is a collection of libraries that you can use independently because they have their own value, but when you use them together, they become a robotic simulator. And the reason that it really goes well with ROS, and it was meant to be working so well with ROS, is because you basically can just use the same software in the simulation and in the robot, right? So you talk to the simulation through from ROS, and then the same way you talk to the simulation, you can talk to your own robot. You have to change the very minimal changes, and then everything should be working. So that saves a lot of time in robotics, where hardware problems can be a major issue when you're running tests. These are some of the distributions from ROS, from gazebo, and now I'm going to go over the Robotics Middleware Framework happening here in Singapore. So this framework started as a problem that was happening here at Changi General Hospital, which is they had one fleet of robots and they wanted to add another one from another vendor. So that brings a lot of problems because the robots don't talk to each other. The robots might have their own needs, like they need a certain line, they cannot share hallways, they cannot share elevators and infrastructure, right? So then they basically called Open Robotics and they said, hey, can you help us build a solution for this and make it open source so everyone in Singapore can benefit from it? And then we can all also collaborate and make it freely available. So what did Open Robotics build? There's a solution now that allows you to manage these robots all together. You can integrate your fleet of robots with RMF, and then you can do task planning and allocation. There's a dashboard where you can select which tasks you need to do, and then robots will be selected to perform the tasks. It can manage your fleet traffic, so if there's these problems with the robots that they find each other in paths, then you can deconflict this traffic. It integrates with the infrastructure, so we have adapters for doors and lifts, and work cells, which are basically dispensers, robots that will, this is an example of dispensing a bottle, a can of Milo to a robot. There's a bunch of tools that came with it. So you get a traffic editor, which is basically a way to design the floor that allows you to generate a simulation world. And it also allows you to generate the nav graph that you can use for the robot's navigation. It has the core, which is the one that takes part on this task allocation, the conflicting traffic, and all that. And it has a dashboard. This picture is not updated, but it is something like that, where you can basically select what tasks the robots need to do and when they need to do it. There's many open source assets that have been made publicly available. So you can find them on appgazebosim.org. These are all the companies in Singapore that are part of this collaboration that are somehow also taking part. You can see Changi Airport, GovTech, CGH, many people working together. So if you're interested, where to start? There's a bunch of ROS links here if you want to get started with ROS. Same for gazebo, same for OpenRMF. Basically, you get the website, you get some place to ask questions, and then you get some place to discuss, like usually discourse. and a bunch of GitHub repos. So there's so many community events. ROSCON is the main one. So we run ROSCON once a year. And the last 2 years it's been online, but we're hoping to get a new one. We did the last year in Japan. Sorry, that was in real life. And the next one coming in New Orleans. And there's also many other events that happen around the world, not only ROSCON. There's the local community events. And I wanted to announce that the ROS Meetup Singapore is back, and we're doing it as part of the robotics track here at FOSSASIA. So big thanks to FOSSASIA for helping us run this. And if you guys want to attend, I'll be giving a very, very basic introduction to ROS for everyone that doesn't know anything about ROS and still wants to get started into the robotics world and wants to know what is this ROS about. I'll be introduction from zero, and the rest, so you can attend the rest and still understand what's going on. And yeah, thank you very much. I hope that was, let's try to make some better robots than this. Yeah, thank you.